That is right. That's one of my favorite hymns. Good morning.
Good morning.
And happy Labor Day. You've already exceeded my expectations just by virtue of being here. I didn't know what we were going to expect on this Labor Day. I'm glad that we're able to gather in Jesus' name and time and place. Several little bits and pieces of announcements to share with you. And if you hear me missing something, please just feel free to yell, scream, jump up and down, say, hey, stupid, whatever. I'll pay attention and respond. First of all, thank you, Beth Whitmire. We need to, within our hearts, sing happy birthday to Tom Mallets. His birthday is, when was Tom? Is it today? So if you see Tom and Linnea, wish him well. I wanted to make sure that y'all know that that there are some kind of happy and sort of exciting things that are in the works in our family of faith. One is that we are planning to do a Kirken of the Tartans on the 11th. Details are to be forthcoming as to how that will work, but we are working on it. One idea, if the stars align and if all be agreeable, is that we might do it at the park at Westview. So stay tuned for more details as they unfold. Another thing that I'm kind of awkward and a little uncomfortable about sharing with you is that somebody thought it would be a good idea to appreciate the pastor. The pastor thinks that's a wonderful idea too, so thank you. But we are planning to do that in the form of an outdoor picnic kind of over here by the portico and in the surrounding area on October 25th, I'm assuming after worship probably. Unless y'all want to do that instead of worship, you know, because we could do that. We could make that happen. Another piece that I'm kind of intrigued by is that I've started a conversation with Stone Workman, and we have yet to work out anything definitive. But I feel this sense that children are, with some company accepted, are sort of missing in our worship, and I feel that missingness, that absence, pretty profoundly. And so we want to see if we can figure out a way to bring time with children back into our worship service in a way that keeps kids safe and keeps everybody else safe as well. So I'll let you know more about that when I know more about that, but at least it feels good that we're kind of trying to move in that direction. So I'm hopeful and excited. Several of you have done a marvelous job in spite of the fact that I've done a really bad job. I was supposed to have announced last Sunday that we are soliciting recommendations for the nominating committee to work through in terms of building a slate of nominees for the upcoming class of elders. Several folks have responded. Some folks have self-suggested, perfectly valid and appropriate. So keep up the good work. I think I'm telling you the truth. I think I'm telling you the truth that you have until October 9th as the cutoff time. No? Okay, what was that? September 10th. Yeah, okay. Well, there you go. So we still got a couple of days. See, that's why y'all got to keep me honest. I appreciate that, John. Thank you. But that's really a wonderful process. I have served congregations where even just getting recommendations from the congregation for the nominating committee is just about like pulling teeth. And so y'all's willingness to participate in the process really actually makes the process work, and that is a great blessing. I also want to share with you the reminder that we're continuing our Wednesday evening Zoom meetings. If you are interested in participating in that and have the internet bandwidth, please know that you will be welcome. This week's passage is from James chapter 3, verses 13 through 18. I'm particularly fond of, those of you who have been doing this know that Dr. Gray kind of writes this paragraph in which she imagines God's response to us as we pray. I wanted to share with you her response, her imagined response from God in light of these verses. I'm going to skip the verses. Y'all have to read those. But imagine this is God speaking to us. Beware of being too sure you are right. Often an unwillingness to yield is linked with a selfish disposition. My wisdom does not push others around or refuse to listen to differing points of view. Human wisdom is often about winning. My wisdom is about healing and saving and redeeming. Next time someone disagrees with you, be quiet. Put yourself in a listening posture and ask me to show you what is wise and true. This way of being with others bears a rich harvest of good fruit. I just just really like that. That speaks deeply to me. I think it's profound, and it suggests a posture of humility in our relationships with each other. I don't know about y'all, that's a hard place for me to be, because I, after all, know better than y'all do what's good for you. And if you would just be reasonable and do it my way, all would be well. Thank you for laughing. Finally, I would share with you, for whatever it is worth, as we gather in worship, that I learned from our presbytery executive earlier this week that we are one of five congregations in our presbytery of about 50-ish congregations that are gathering in worship. All the rest of folks either are not gathering at all or are doing so solely in a virtual setting. So recognize that as the blessing that it is for us today. Friends, do y'all have any other announcements that we need to add? Our call to worship then is from Psalm 100. Praise the Lord. Sing to the Lord a new song. Let Israel be glad in its maker. Let the children of Zion rejoice in their king. Let them praise the Lord's name with dancing, making melody to God with tambourine and lyre. That doesn't sound like a Presbyterian service at all, does it? For the Lord takes pleasure in the people. God adorns the humble with victory. Let the faithful exult in glory. Let them sing for joy in their couches. Friends, let us worship God. us pray. Almighty God, we approach you with reverence and hope, aware as we do that so often we don't even know the words to express our deepest fears and our most heartfelt needs. We tell ourselves that we believe that you know what's going on within us even before we do, and yet we struggle to trust, to believe the promise of your presence, the certainty of your willingness to provide, and your power to work for good in ways that we probably won't necessarily see, but in which we can always rely. Lord, help us to rely on your grace, because as we do, we bring to you all that is broken and dysfunctional and frightening and uncertain and scary about life right now. We lift up the concerns of our community and our families, the worries that keep us awake nights, and surrounded as we are by 24/7 media, we see images of destruction of communities in flame and towns and states engulfed by winds and water. We're overwhelmed, Lord. And yet we pray for all who are impacted by disasters, both man-made and natural. Sustain the weary, strengthen the weak. Empower your people to be the helpers in Jesus' name that you have called us to be. Do not let us back away from loving our neighbors now and through all of the months of recovery that are yet to come. Lord, comfort those who grieve, heal the sick, encourage the caregivers, provide for your people who are unable to make ends meet. Make of us your followers, people who fish for people, and mend the safety nets that keep your children from drowning when the storms of life grow strong. Help us to live in a caring and loving community, and help us to embody that care and love for our neighbors. Lord, hear the cries of your people and guide us to find ways that serve you by setting them free. Free from oppression, from exploitation, from anything that prohibits the abundant life in Christ that you call us to live and to share. Lord, bless our nation. Make us healed and make us whole by your great grace and presence in Jesus' name. We offer this prayer and all of our prayers, mindful that our Lord has taught us how to pray. And so we share his prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Finally here, and it's a new day. Oh, it's a new day. technical difficulties here. So it did this morning, too. How about we just stop?
Okay.
We'll just stop it. So thank you.
And we've been doing so well with technology right up until then. Thank you for laughing. Do you know? I got to step away from the pulpit for a second just because this is, I don't know, I'm going to mess with you. I'll stand right here, okay? Y'all are just not good Presbyterians. And I mean that as a compliment. I truly, sincerely do. Good Presbyterians, at least the ones that I grew up with, are very staid and very formal and very rigid. And the idea of using recorded music, let alone upbeat, energetic recorded music in worship, would have just been unthinkable in my childhood. And I see Steve Jordan nodding his head too, so he knows what I'm talking about. And here we are. And the idea that we would just kind of chuckle and laugh at our own human frailties and failings when we have technological glitches, we're supposed to gasp in horror. You know that, right? I mean, we're supposed to, and we didn't. Y'all are beautiful. You really, really need to know that. Okay, now I'm going to go back up here. You ready? I'm going back up here. I have a great advantage over y'all. I know what scripture passage I'm going to read, and since I know what scripture passage I'm going to read, I printed it out ahead of time so that I can just turn right to it. I'm going to slow down just a little bit, and if you have brought a Bible, electronic or paper, and you want to find the passage to read with me, I'm going to read from the 5th chapter of Matthew's Gospel, verses 17 through 48. This particular version is the New Revised Standard, which is what we usually have in our pews. You might find another version that you like better. This is a kind of a central point in Jesus' Sermon on the Mount in Matthew's Gospel. So I'm going to count to 5, and then I'm going to start reading, okay? So 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Okay. Friends, listen. This is God's word for us. Jesus said, "Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have not come to abolish, but to fulfill. For truly, I tell you, until heaven and earth pass away, not one letter, not one stroke of a letter." King James Version had a great phrase there, jots and tittles, and we'll talk about that in a little bit. "Not one will pass away from the law until all is accomplished. Therefore, whoever breaks one of the least of these commandments and teaches others to do the same will be called least in the kingdom of heaven, but whoever does them and teaches them will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. You have heard that it was said to those of ancient times, 'You shall not murder, and whoever murders shall be liable to judgment.' But I say to you that if you are angry with a brother or sister, you will be liable to judgment. And if you insult a brother or a sister, you will be liable to the council. And if you say, 'You fool,' you will be liable to the hell of fire. So when you are offering your gift at the altar, if you remember that your brother or sister has something against you, leave your gift there before the altar and go. First, be reconciled to your brother and sister, and then come and offer your gift. Come to terms quickly with your accuser while you're on the way to court with him. Or your accuser may hand you over to the judge and the judge to the guard, and you'll be thrown in prison. Truly, I tell you, you will never get out until you have paid the last penny. You have heard that it was said, 'You shall not commit adultery.' But I say to you that everyone who looks at a woman with lust has already committed adultery with her in his heart. If your eye causes you to sin, tear it out and throw it away. It is better for you to lose one of your members than for your whole body to be thrown into hell. And if your right hand causes you to sin, cut it off and throw it away. It is better for you to lose one of your members than for your whole body to go to hell. It was also said, whoever divorces his wife, let him give her a certificate of divorce. But I say to you that anyone who divorces his wife, except on the ground of unchastity, causes her to commit adultery, and whoever marries a divorced woman commits adultery. Again, you have heard that it was said to those of ancient times, you shall not swear falsely, but carry out the vows you have made to the Lord. But I say to you, do not swear at all, either by heaven, for it is the throne of God, or by earth, for it is his footstool, or by Jerusalem, for it is the city of the great king. And do not swear by your head, for you cannot make one hair white or black. Let your word be yes, yes, or no, no. Anything more than this comes from the evil one. You have heard that it was said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. But I say to you, do not resist an evildoer. If anyone strikes you on the right cheek, turn the other also. And if anyone wants to sue you and take your coat, give your cloak as well. And if anyone forces you to go 1 mile, go also the second mile. Give to everyone who begs from you, and do not refuse anyone who wants to borrow from you. Y'all feeling overwhelmed yet? I am. You have heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, so that you may be children of your Father in heaven. For he makes his sun rise on the evil and on the good, and sends rains on the righteous and on the unrighteous. For if you love those who love you, what reward do you have? Do not even the tax collectors do the same? And if you greet only your brothers and sisters, what more are you doing than others? Do not even the Gentiles do the same? Be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Father is perfect. Friends, may thanks be to God. This is the word of our Lord. Amen. I really can't tell you for sure whether I think this is a sermon or a collection of random musings that's strung together by an approach to theology, or whether it's something else entirely. I think you, as the body of Christ and the Spirit of Christ, will have to determine whether this says what God needs it to say or not. I think it comes close to saying what I feel the need to say, and I thank you in advance for your kindness and indulgence this week. The first thing I want to say is that I have been deeply, deeply hurt by the church. Not you, this congregation, but by the church as a whole in various settings and in various places. I have also been profoundly helped by the church. And this does emphatically include all y'all. All y'all is a good Southern plural, just in case you didn't know that. Likewise, I have to confess that I have deeply hurt the Church of Jesus Christ. Hopefully not here so far, but I absolutely have, as a human being who struggles with ego and pride and fear and anxiety and all of those things that get in the way of following where Jesus leads. And at the same time, I think I have to say that in some small way, perhaps, I have been of help and service to the Church of Jesus Christ. I'm not all one way or all another way. I don't get to wear a white hat, and I don't get to wear a black hat. I kind of live someplace in the middle, on the way. I think that fits into the rest of this conversation, because this all began several weeks ago when I was having lunch with a friend, and the subject of politics came up in our discussions with each other. And You know, let's face it, folks, this is a presidential election year, and there's a lot up for grabs, and there's a lot of emotional energy and a lot of fear and a lot of anxiety. My friend and I didn't dive too deeply into the subject, but it was just sufficient for us to discover that we were generally inclined to see the world through a similar set of lenses. And so we found ourselves in our conversation wondering if the day would ever come when the politics of the left and the politics of the right would somehow meet in the middle. And I've been mulling on and praying over that conversation ever since it happened. It started me in the process of thinking about the lenses that we all choose to make sense of the world, as well as the labels that we use to identify ourselves as insiders and other folks as outsiders. And that led me in turn to a recollection that I share with you. This is a true story. Might not be an exciting story, but it's a true story. When I left Charleston in 1992 to begin my studies at Union Theological Seminary, if you had asked me at that time, I would have told you that I was a fairly moderate, middle-of-the-road kind of guy with regard to all things social and political and theological. And when I arrived at the campus of Union Theological Seminary in Richmond, Virginia, it's now called Union Presbyterian Seminary, UPS, unfortunate choice of nicknames, I think. Anyhow, when I got there, what I learned very quickly was that in the eyes of many, perhaps even most of my fellow students, my self-assessment was in error because I was actually a hard-nosed, right-wing, neo-fascist, reactionary conservative. And I even got an award for it on a couple of occasions, but that's a whole other story. And when I graduated from Union Seminary 3 years later and took up my first call as a shiny new pastor in Whiteville, North Carolina, I discovered there that my seminary colleagues and my prior self-assessment were both in error because I was actually a fanatical socialist communist sympathizing anarchist. Then a few years later, when I accepted the call to serve as the associate pastor for First Pres in Aiken, I was relieved to learn that I was, in truth, a fairly moderate and middle-of-the-road kind of guy, as I thought I was. And that held true for 5 years until I was called to serve the congregation in John's Island, where the most fascinating thing happened. I learned there that according to the local folks, the Benyes, who could trace their ancestry back to the late 1600s, I was indeed a wild-eyed liberal, while in the eyes of the Fortune 500 Nouveau Riche folks who lived in Seabrook and in Kiowa, they are the Cumyes in the low country dialect. As far as they were concerned, I was a starchy, stiff-necked, narrow-minded conservative. And so I got to wear both of those hats for 10 years. It's kind of neat. The point I'm trying to make with this is that in large measure, what you see depends a great deal on where you stand. Now, I know that by this point in time, whether you're online or whether you're here in person, you have heard me say on at least one occasion, just to issue sort of an invitation to say, you know, let's all make it a practice to leave our politics out on the porch before we come together in worship together, assembled as the body of Christ. And that's an important invitation. It is my personal conviction that our faith in our risen Lord and Savior is supposed to shape our politics. But I think that way too often we get it turned around backwards and we let our politics shape our understanding of our Lord. In the 25 years that I have been a teaching elder, which by itself is surprising to me, I can't believe y'all haven't already fired me someplace along the line. In those 25 years, I have frequently and sometimes painfully discovered that my biases and values have shaped my vision of Jesus so much so that, well, by gum, Jesus looks just like John. instead of John growing in faith to become more like Jesus. Let me share with you another true story. We will get to Scripture eventually, I promise. When I was, I don't know, 7 or 8 years old, and my dad was driving me into elementary school one day, used to have a baby blue or a robin's egg blue Volkswagen Bug with no air conditioning in Jacksonville, Florida. It was miserable, but he loved that car. And so we were riding down the road, and he spotted a bumper sticker, and I'm sure y'all have seen those bumper stickers. Bumper sticker says, "God is my co-pilot." Well, Dad kind of snorted as he pointed it out to me, and he said, "Son, if you think that God is your co-pilot, you probably need to switch seats so that God is the pilot." As you can tell, that little insight, that random snippet just stuck with me. It's had a profound influence on how I understand myself and on how I try to practice discipleship. Because it is so very easy to get our priorities wrong side up. So, here's where Scripture comes in. You got to wonder, does any of this have anything to do with letters of and strokes of a letter, with jots and tittles in the King James? I love that phrase. Here's where we'll jump in a little bit. Let me start by saying that I think there are two kinds of people in this world. There are those who believe there are two kinds of people, and there are those who don't. But more to the point, there are two kinds of people in this world. There's the letter of the law folks on the one hand, and the spirit of the law folks on the other hand. And here, Jesus calls out both kinds of us folks. See, a more literal translation of this verse might say something closer to, this is Jesus speaking, "I am telling you in total truth that until heaven and earth pass away, not the smallest Hebrew letter yod, or even the tiniest little hook on the shape of a letter called a horn or a kerif will pass from the law until all is accomplished." I was fascinated when I started to look at that. See, for a Hebrew mindset, for the Jewish mindset, the letters themselves were considered holy once they were written down on a roll of Torah, of Scripture, of law. To this day, those specially trained scribes who actually write out Hebrew Torah are so cautious and so meticulous about writing each and every one of those individual letters on that handwritten scroll that even the slightest change or omission, even the smallest missing part of a letter, means that they are required to destroy the entire scroll and start over. The letters are just held in that much high regard. The teachers of the law stressed this importance of the law of God. And so they kind of devised this teaching story. They said that Sarai's name was changed to Sarah in Scripture. And when that happened, as the establishment of the covenant was unfolding, the yod, which is the tiny little kind of a comma that's above the line in Hebrew, was taken out from her name. And it cried out from generation to generation of chosen people, protesting its removal from Scripture, until finally the day came that Moses changed Hosea's name to Joshua. And it was when that happened that the yod, the J sound in the front of Joshua, was returned to Scripture. And so, according to the teaching, not even the smallest letter can pass from Scripture. And this is exactly what Jesus is drawing on here, is that tradition, that understanding. Even the smallest details of God's law are essential. And then Jesus goes from there, making this point, to providing 5 separate, profoundly uncomfortable sermon illustrations, if you live my life, to show that where the letter of the law is essential, the spirit of the law is every bit as important. Adherence to the letter of the law, a apart from the loving spirit of the law is heartless legalism. That's easy to spot. On the other hand, insisting that we favor the spirit of the law apart from the letter is actually devoid of meaning. Because as Jesus teaches, the spirit of the law is actually more demanding than the letter, and not less. Both letter and spirit are intertwined and essential to one another for a life of faith even to be a possibility. Now the Pharisees, for their part, they were committed to a conspicuous, visible kind of formal obedience, a rigid conformity to the law. If you grew up of a certain age and you remember not dancing or playing cards or finding stores open on Sunday, you probably experienced what some of that legalism was like. I know that I did. Jesus teaches that God's commands, God's demands, are far more radical than this superficial version of obedience. There's a crusty old conservative Presbyterian theologian, I can't remember his name anymore, but he wrote this. He said, "We must not imagine that when we have the Spirit, we can dispense with the law, because what the Spirit does in our hearts is precisely to write God's law there." So Spirit and law, righteousness and heart, they all belong together. You see, like so much of our faith, this is not about an either-or proposition. That's the world that we live in that really wants us to choose up sides, either this or that. Rather, this business of faith is a both-and proposition, which makes it messy and difficult and uncertain and approximate and, frankly, impossible if it's just up to us. But it's not. Both and, heart and mind, body and soul, guilt and grace, love and law, letter and spirit. As nearly as I can tell, every time the church has chosen up sides and gone to war within the family, the sides have been chosen in a way that very well-intended folks pull apart from each other by pulling apart heart from mind and guilt from grace and love from law and letter from spirit. This world that we're living in right now, it really appears to be intensely interested in polarization, in division, in choosing up sides, in shoring up defenses and rationalizations of becoming us versus them. And it is tempting, oh so tempting, to bring this spirit of division into our faith, because you don't have to be honest with me. This might not be true at all. I think it is, though. We are each convinced that our people are the right people, while their people, well, you know, their people, they're heartless right-wing neo-fascists or they're fanatical socialist anarchists. I've been both. It's been interesting. This has always been a struggle in the church, and I suspect that it always will be. Jesus had to deal with us versus them in his own followers, and a sizable portion of Paul's correspondence to the early church goes into addressing the divisions caused by human desire to have our perspective be the one that comes out on top as being righteous and holy. It is so very easy for each one of us to proudly declare, like the bumper sticker, "God is my co-pilot," without even recognizing that we've reversed our priorities and we've served our personal agendas rather than serving Jesus, even though we might throw his name around a lot in the process of making ourselves feel justified and feel better. We need each other. It is as simple as that. You know what I'm about to tell you is true. Neither birds nor planes are capable of flight if they have only one wing. It matters not whether it's a left wing or a right wing. We need each other in order to be whole. Heart and mind, body and soul, guilt and grace, love and law, letter and spirit. You see, here's the wonderful thing about y'all. I've been here for 9 months under these strange and bizarre circumstances that we're all living through together. And I've tried to get my arms wrapped around your identity as a congregation. And from what I can tell so far, and y'all certainly can correct me, one of the things about y'all that I think is really, really beautiful is that you are a home for folks from a wide variety of political and theological perspectives. In the language of the day, it seems to me that you're not a red congregation and you're not a blue congregation. You're maybe more of a purple congregation. I think that's pretty neat. If this is so, it means that somewhere along the line, God has blessed our family of faith with a great deal of grace and loving patience and restraint. That's forbearance, by the way, another good biblical word. Forbearance is powerful. And I want to encourage all of us to give thanks to God that we are so very blessed. In the coming days, my hope is that you will make it a point to include our congregation's beautiful unity in your prayers. I would encourage you to pray as well for our nation, for our state, for our community as well. For the Spirit of Christ to use us as the hands and feet, the hearts and minds that speak a word of forbearance, of grace, of justice, of mercy into the world around us. Pray that we, in sharing this amazing unity in our unusual diversity, might become foundations for the expressions of mission and ministry in our little corner of the world that we can't even imagine yet. And above all, pray that our neighbors will know of our love for Christ by seeing it in our love for each other and for them as well. May God bless this, the reading and the hearing and the proclaiming of his holy word. Amen.
I don't have hymn books out there, but we're going to be doing Great is Thy Faithfulness. I know most of y'all probably know that one. It's one of my favorites. We'll be doing verse number 1 and verse number 3.
Oh,
So I was kind of long-winded. I apologize. Friends, it really is just as simple as it is not easy. Love. That simple. The not easy part is love God with all of your heart and all of your mind and all of your soul and all of your strength, which you know is completely beyond our human limitations and capacities. And yet, inspired and empowered by the Spirit of Christ, this becomes the foundational love which enables us to go further, to love our neighbors who are near to us, our neighbors who are far from us, our neighbors who are like us, our neighbors who are not like us, our neighbors who are likable, and our neighbors who are by no means likable. We love them because Jesus, our Lord, has first loved us. Go from this place then as brothers and sisters in Jesus Christ and live by this law. And as you go, may the grace and the mercy and the peace of God the Father and God the Son and God the Holy Ghost be with each and every single uniquely wonderful one of you and all of us throughout all of this life and into life everlasting. Amen.